Greetings! It is I, Tantus Narivan Dracovin, Lord and Emperor of the Dracovin Empire, and welcome. It is time to continue my discussion on the 5th edition of Dungeons & Dragons 5e D&D. Well, we were last talking, we talked about ability scores. Well, ability checks in general, too. Let's dive into those a little bit more. So an ability check is really called upon to see if a character succeeds upon some kind of task, whatever task that might be. There might be a time or a place that once my character has made a check, maybe they fail it. But circumstances could be that I could try again. There's certain things that you can just try to do again. There's no negative side effects for failing. Well, there might be negative side effects for failing, but it does not prevent attempting again. Failure might not prevent it, like attempting to leap across between two buildings. I might fail and fall, but then I could always climb back on the building I started on and try again. It doesn't stop me from doing it. There's going to be something bad happening with that, but just think of it the circumstances like that. I could try again. So, when we have a check that you could attempt again, regardless of the circumstances, you could have your players just allow them to keep doing it until they succeed. Or if it's a task that time doesn't matter with, and there's no side effect for taking a lot of time doing it, you could just take 10 times the amount of time it would have normally done to do the normal task and say it's done. So if it's just like you're practicing leaps between two different things, that if you fail, there's no damage, no bad side effects, you could say, rather than it will take you a minute to jump across successfully. You're taking your time, you're aiming yourself out, you're then leaping into action, doing it. There are other circumstances where it might take you that restricted amount, a little bit more time, and just say you could do it. Now, there are also circumstances when, it's not going to be possible to check again. That once you've checked, it stops you from being attempting to do it. That's like trying to deceive a guard, try to trick them. Once you've done it and you've failed to deceive them, they're not going to believe you if you attempt to use the same deception again. Well, in this circumstance, yes, you might not try again. But there are things you can do to change your circumstances. You could attempt another lie, that's a possibility, or try to do something that will allow you to make another check again. Basically, you're setting yourself up for either an alternate check or setting something up that would allow you to use the check again. It requires a little bit more work, finagling, some maybe creativity, but it could try. The only problem is oftentimes with these circumstances where you had one failure, it's going to make the second check more difficult, either a higher DC or maybe even give you something like disadvantage. I might have failed to lie to him again, and I come up with a creative lie that would have given a reason for my first lie, that would also help me to get by this guy. He's probably not going to be as trustworthy, and he might be suspicious, so it's like, yes, more difficult, maybe disadvantage, but I could try again because I earned it through creativity. It's important to note here that your automatic success when you take times for it, that doesn't work on everything. It doesn't make the impossible possible. It's just that there's a circumstance, if you would take a lot of time working on this, and you don't have any kind of, if I fail, I can try again, it doesn't stop me from trying again, go ahead and do it. If nothing's stopping you from trying again, in some current cases like damage might stop you from trying again, or getting into a fight, I think there are a lot of reasons to stop you from trying it again. But if I have no reason to not try it again, I can take the time and do it. As long as it's not impossible. Now, a contest would be basically a competition between two different creatures that they attempt to use their own ability checks, their own ability scores, pitted against each other to prove one is more powerful at that check than the other. One is victorious. Well, when I say powerful, it sounds like it's strength, but contests of strengths are, yes, the easiest one. But there's other contests that could be out there. Dexterity, stamina, for constitution, intelligence, for knowledge. There are lots of different types of contests. Regardless, though, once a contest is established between two characters to see who is superior, they will roll off on the appropriate ability checks. This will be determined by your Dungeon Master. And your Dungeon Master could see the competition here as a direct competition. Basically, I roll one ability check, I roll the same ability check, we can compare them. Or it could be more of a a contest between two different scores that are opposites of each other. For example, if this character here is attempting to be stealthy, and this one here is attempting to notice them being stealthy, well, it's stealth and perception. They aren't having a stealth off. They're having one try to be stealthy and the other compete with it by trying to notice the stealthy one using perception. So you can see these are technically opposites that might be called upon to roll as a DM calls for it. Sometimes an attack roll is called for when it requires you to hit some kind of creature or object that might be blocked by armor, shields, or have some other kind of object that has cover for it. An attack does not necessarily mean combat, though, also. The fact that there are various contests that would use attack rolls. Things like if I'm playing darts in a bar. Hey, darts calls for an attack roll. I'm attacking the bullseye. There you go. It's requiring me to roll an attack, but I'm not technically rolling an attack in combat. So attack rolls could be an option for a type of an ability check that you would be called upon, more than just your normal ability checks, more than just your skills. Now, another type of ability check you might be called upon to roll is, of course, the saving throw. That is also another type of ability check. It is a check in order to avoid some kind of negative effect that is suddenly coming upon your character. Something bad is happening to them, and saving throw is your physical or mental or spiritual body's gut reaction to attempt to avoid it. It's you as a whole attempting to avoid the negative effects of whatever's going on. Something bad happens, you want to avoid it. This is never a character choice that these things are happening. You're not choosing to make a save. This is sort of more of an instinctual thing that occurs, a gut reaction. It's split second. Oh no, a fireball is coming out at me. I want to avoid the flames, or dragons breathing fire. Let me get some cover. Things like that. Or, oh, someone's trying to wrest control of my mind. No, you don't. This is a split second escape from whatever's going on to you, and instinctually you will avoid it. Now, there is oftentimes a call for a save when it comes to things similar to expel or similar based effects. I'm getting hit by a spell, I will make a saving throw. Most spells or effects will list not only what type of saving throw you'll be making, the type of throw it will be, but it will also oftentimes give you guidelines or a straight up difficulty to roll against. Basically, guidelines for difficulty or the difficulty. Oftentimes, monsters might have difficulties associated with their abilities. Spellcasters, it will tell you how to figure out their difficulty based upon, of course, their proficiency and things like that. These are ways that you determine the AI DCs. There are other things or circumstances that could occur that might seem like they call for a save, but it doesn't tell you the type of save and it doesn't type you the difficulty. That can also occur. The fact is also, you as a dungeon master can change saves anytime. If circumstances might become change in some kind of way, or alter in some kind of way that you feel a DC for a save is not appropriate, either it's too high or too low, you could alter it. Of course, oftentimes you can do things like give advantage or disadvantage, but that's because gut reactions, those don't fit as much as often they sometimes do. If you are building your own saving throw for some kind of encounter that did not have one, then you could definitely either come up with it on your own, or you could discuss it a little bit with your PCs to see what is appropriate, take suggestions. That's not something that's a terrible thing to do. The fact is, when a circumstance that's quite random that calls for a save that you weren't expecting comes up, maybe kind of figuring out what would be appropriate at the circumstance is a good thing. Your characters could say, I'm going to attempt to do this to avoid this, and you could say, oh, that seems more like a strength-based save. Or they could say that they're going to try to do something else, and you're like, oh, that sounds like you're trying to do a dex-based save. Basically, what your characters are planning to do in response to the circumstance which seems to call for a save might tell you what kind of save it is. And at that point in time, also what they're attempting will give you an idea of the DC it will be. You can use these two numbers to sort of eke out what the kind of save will be. And again, we're talking to my characters about this, so I'm getting save-based suggestions from them. Now, it will be your job as a DM to, well, establish difficulties. We did talk a little bit about difficulties when it came to, of course, saving throws, how you can alter those saving throw difficulties. But really, when we're talking about any kind of check that you're going to be making, any kind of check a player is going to be making, or you yourself are going to be putting together because of circumstances, it's going to have a difficulty to it. Sometimes the difficulty is the other character's number for a contest. It could be the AC of something for an attack roll. Could be the DC of the save. But there can be other circumstances where it's just a straight ability check in some kind of circumstance, and I need a DC. You're going to have to look to what these difficulties are for them. Now, you could start out at the easiest, difficulty 5. There are basically 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. 30 being the highest difficulty you can have. 5 is such a low difficulty that unless it's special circumstances, I would not call for your characters to roll a difficulty 5 check. 5 check is so easy, just assume that they're going to complete it unless the negative effects of them failing are so bad, and the fact is that they could fail. Look at what they have. If my characters get a plus 4, they can get that 5 automatically. You know, if my characters only get a plus 2, then yeah, they could fail, or a plus 0. And if, let's say, the negative connotations of failing this really, really easy check is death, then yeah, I would call for them to roll it. Like, if you're, like, walking across these boards, which seem, like, a little off balance, but they're pretty easy to walk on, but you could plummet to your death on the side of it, then yeah, call for the check. But if it's just like, oh, I'm going to walk some beams, and if I fall down, I kind of knock myself on the ground, and it's difficulty 5 for these little beams. No. Don't bother to say, eh, you did it. Most of the time when you're looking to your DCs, you're going to look to your 10s, 15s, and 20s. These tasks here are varying levels of difficulties, but are effectively establishing the ones that most characters at most levels will be able to do, and depending on the circumstances, it still might be a trouble. Even at 20th level, a DC 20 check is not a given by a character. They're going to not have plus 20 at that point in time. They're only going to have their proficiency and their ability score, which may only be around like maybe 10, let's say. Maybe higher than that if they're lucky, but that would be a proficient skill. That is the kind of idea of what it would be. That's why 20 is still difficult even at higher levels. That's why you have to kind of judge appropriately for your DCs. Once you start getting above there, it becomes very difficult. For a good example, 25, unless a character's proficient in whatever they are attempting to do, well, because we're using, of course, skill slash ability checks as our good example here, because most of the time you're going to call for more of a skill-based check rather than just a straight-up check. That's a little bit of a different explaining there for that, but let's give it a good example. 25, a low-level character could theoretically do that if they have some proficiency. Will they? Probably not. High level characters, better chance, but not given. 30 should be nearly impossible for any low level characters, and even high level characters would have a difficult time with it. So you can see those are the upper ends of the difficulties because they are, well, so difficult. Not impossible, just really difficult. But that's it for today. So we talked about your ability checks. We went over the basics of ability checks. We talked about attack rolls, saving throws, making multiple ability checks, and what your difficulty class is going to be. In the next episode, we're going to dive into automatic successes a little bit more, talking about using them. Then we're going to talk about your proficiencies, and a big one, advantage and disadvantage. These are important things to talk about as you on the DM side, because you're going to have to know how to use these all appropriately. You as a player might want to know about them too. But I hope you're having a great day. If you've had any kind of interesting checks that you've had to do that were kind of improvised because of circumstances that you ended up in or were attempting something really cool, let me know about it. Something that you had failure or success, if it was really cool that you were going to attempt to do it. Let me know that part at least. Regardless though, until the next time, I bid you farewell.